Well, we welcome you once again to this Sabbath day worship from Trinity United Methodist Church in downtown Red Springs, North Carolina. Our sanctuary is empty this morning, except for key people that have a role in this service. One person sitting on the back pew, and that would be my wife, Sue, who keeps me straight. So this is the day that the Lord has made, and let us rejoice and let us be glad in it. We are broadcasting by Facebook Live as well as YouTube. It's been a difficult week for our community and a difficult week for our nation and indeed the world as we struggle with this pandemic virus that's right now seems unstoppable. But we know that as people of faith, that our God is greater than any tiny bug that we can't even see. I'd like to acknowledge the presence of Penny McDonald, our music director, on the piano this morning. Kim McMillan on the camera and also our soloist for the day and our IT person. As well as Cindy Bowles, who would be here to back up Kim on the camera, as well as Jackie Rentz, who will be bringing our youth time a little later. Churches and pastors are having struggles. We're having struggles exploring ways to continue to serve, continuing to share the Word of God with their faithful church family. So I've asked you to remember this morning that Trinity is not closed, just like most churches. We're just worshiping in a different way, continuing to serve in a different way. This too shall pass, and our faith will be made stronger than ever. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and we will gather again in the same format as Jesus begins his journey to the cross. Again, I would welcome you to Trinity. So let us pray. Gracious and loving and hearing God, I humble myself before you asking for your hand during these most difficult times as we struggle with so many uncertainties. A raging virus that threatens to overwhelm our hospitals, that threatens to collapse our financial institutions, skyrocketing in unemployment, job losses, empty store shelves. But Holy God, we know that you and you alone are our refuge. We know that you're our strength, our present in times of trouble. So take our hands, Heavenly Father, and do not let us fall. Let your grace fall upon us like healing waters. We humble ourselves and humbly ask that you would touch those who are sick. Touch those struggling with so many uncertainties in their lives. We pray that you would surround with your armor of protection, those who even as we pray, take care of the sick. The doctors, the nurses, the staff, for all those that man our hospitals, those on the front lines of our war against this virus, protect them. Protect their families as they return home. Strengthen our faith, Heavenly Father. Make us more kind. Make us more loving. Make us more willing to reach out and fix our hearts and minds to that glorious time when we can again worship you in a stronger and more loving community of faith. And we pray this prayer in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And this time I'd call on Jackie Rentz to bring our message to our young people.
Good morning. Today, our scripture is from Psalms 55, verse 22. It says, "Cast your burden on the Lord, and he will sustain you. He will never permit the righteous to be moved." When I think of burden, I think about worries. And you know right now, we all have many, many worries. We have a lot of sick people that didn't make it. We have also, your parents have all their children at home. We have grocery stores that are empty. So we have a lot of worries right now. But the Lord says to cast your burdens on him, and he will sustain us. He will take care of us. I believe that no matter what, my faith will of the Lord will sustain me. All you have to do is turn all these worries over to God. It doesn't mean that we don't have to do things that we need to do in order to protect ourselves. We need to stay home. But the most important thing is that we need to turn over our burdens to God. Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, first I want to thank you for the many, many blessings that you have bestowed upon me. Be with all the sick. Be with the worried people, dear Heavenly Father, and let them have faith to give their burdens to you. I pray this in the name of Jesus, your Son. Amen.
We see.
Thank you, Kim, for that beautiful, beautiful words of reminder there. What a wonderful gift God has given you. It occurred to me that since we have no bulletin that we're passing out there, that perhaps it would be appropriate to give you the title to my message. It's bring the toxic trash in your heart and leave it at the foot of the cross. Bring the toxic trash in your heart and leave it at the foot of the cross. Let us pray. Well, gracious God, I would ask that the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Sometimes we take thanks to the Lord and leave it at the foot of the cross, but only for a short time later to take it back again. Well, just because we don't hear the air that we breathe does not mean that we stop breathing. And just because we don't see the answers to our prayers right away does not mean that we stop believing. So hold on, church. Hold on, keep believing. For our God is a God of breakthroughs. Our God is a God of miracles. Stronger than any virus, any tiny bug that we can't even see. This virus too will pass. Our God is stronger. So maybe, just maybe, during these uncertain times, many will turn to Him, and many will grow deeper in their faith. From a personal standpoint, I know I've had to grow deeper in my faith. I've had to reach down very deep in the last couple of months and more, faced and successfully surviving a heart surgery, and now journeying with my faith family through this. I've had to reach down deep. So I invite you to hear these words from the Psalm 55, verse 22. Cast your cares on the Lord, and He will sustain you. He will never let the righteous fall. Church, we're getting to the heart of Lent. So an appropriate question this morning might be, who does God love? Who does God love? Well, the simple answer is that God loves to work. Does it say that God loves this group or that group? Not my Bible. Does it even say that God just loves us Christians? No. Church, it simply says that God so loves the world. That's all of us. Our warts, our tattoos, our attitudes. All of us. Gosh, even me. I don't see how it can be any clearer than that. God loves everybody. And most of us believe that, church. I know that. We believe it with our minds. But do we always believe it with our hearts? Do we act always like we believe it? Well, according to the scripture, all of us have sinned and we've fallen short of the glory of God. All of us. But God loves us anyway. We're all sinners. When I knelt at the altar at annual conference many years ago, one of the questions asked of all of us was, are you going on to perfection? Are you going on to perfection? Not are you perfect. I would have flunked the test right there. Are you going on to perfection? So as we continue our journey through this season of Lent, is there something unpleasant? Is there something sinful that you wish could be taken from you? Some hurt, some secret sin, some resentment maybe some hatred that festers deep within your very being. The problem is, church, that many are adrift and deep in the unconscious. There's some toxic trash floating around. We need to be reminded of these words from the Bible. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in Him may have eternal life. Eternal life, church, begins the moment that you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, at that very moment. Salvation is not something that begins beyond the grave. Salvation is experienced the minute you let Jesus into your heart. And you allow Him to remove that which is rotten. That is decaying. That is hurtful. That is regrettable. The cross, church, makes it possible that you and I can be set free from the garbage that is in danger of fouling our very souls. Sometimes the problem is guilt. Is there someone that you may have hurt? Someone that you may have disappointed? Someone that you may have betrayed? Have you done things which you know are wrong? Things for which you would be deeply ashamed if others found out? Well, if those questions might cause you to be uncomfortable this morning, you've come to the right place, even if you are viewing it on Facebook or YouTube. Even if you are sitting in your living room or your den or your kitchen, drinking a cup of coffee. Even if you're not dressed for church, I do encourage all that you can't make it to your house of worship dress for church in your living room. Jesus wants to lift that burden of guilt and shame from your struggling soul. Perhaps your burden this morning is not guilt. Maybe it's resentment against someone. It might go back for years. It might go back even to your childhood. Or maybe someone has disappointed you recently and you're having a problem forgiving that person. We simply don't know the scars that some people bear. But we see the evidence in the way they lead their lives. We see it in their inability to form meaningful relationships. We see it in broken spirits. We see it in anger and hatred expressed in so many ways. So let me ask you this morning, is there someone in your life that you need to forgive? Now's a good time in this season of Lent. Church, not forgiving is like taking poison and expecting the other person to die. If you carry around unforgiveness in your heart, you need to let it go. That's what the cross is all about. It's about forgiveness. It's about healing. Jesus said as he hung there dying on the cross, "Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do." Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. So let it go. We become whole persons by having the toxic trash deep down in our souls, lifted out and dumped into the depth of the seas. Dumped at the foot of the cross. Then and only then, church, do we become souls fit for this world as well as souls fit for the world to come. Some years ago, a former Archbishop of Canterbury, William Temple, Bishop Temple was asked to speak on the meaning of the cross. He chose two Bible texts. The first text he chose was from the first chapter of Genesis. These words, "And God said, let there be light, and there was light." The second text he chose was from the story of Jesus. The story is Jesus as he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane on that evening before he was crucified. His sweat became like great drops of blood. Church, won't you bring the toxic trash in your heart and just leave them at the foot of the cross? The season of Lent is a good time to do that. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
A penny will share with us a piece of music. Come to Jesus.
Thank you.
blessed you receive this benediction, no matter where you are standing or sitting, or maybe riding in your car. I know as far away as Bethlehem, this service has been viewed. So receive this benediction and leave this time of worship and go in peace. And may the love and the peace and the joy of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, walk with you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.